Last week, we began to talk about moving forward, talked about adjusting the rear view. As I reach up toward that rear view mirror, I don't just see places, I see faces. I see faces like Barbara Keats, who along with her husband Chan, faithfully served in this church for more than a decade, putting in effort, sweat, tears, late nights, early mornings, fasting, praying, believing for a move of God. See faces like Pastor Leo Duncan, our pastor emeritus, who served faithfully under a number of lead pastors in this church before sort of retiring and going to pastor another church in his 80s. Pastor Leo, who was personally involved with the formation of this church. Faces like Mary Barriga, who often slips into the shadows in the rear view. A founding member of this church who for 3 decades has set aside the first Sunday of every month to prepare communion elements that we might receive and share together. Without thanks, without applause, faithfully serving. Yes, friends, when I look in the rearview mirror, there are some faces that are quite a ways back and others that are much closer. I look in the rearview mirror, I see the face of Kathy Fontaine, who came out this week to help take down the Christmas decorations. For the handful who worked for hours carrying things upstairs, cleaning up so we're ready for the next season. But I can't stare too long in the rearview mirror because the windshield's so much bigger. And as we move forward in God's will, one of the things that we have to do is make sure that we're able to focus through that windshield, which means sometimes we need to pause just long enough for a little washing of the windshield. I want to encourage you to turn in your Bible today to Luke chapter 6, where we read a passage of Scripture in which our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ speaks to you and to me about our vision, about the obstructions that blur our vision, about our need to wash the windshield of our lives. Would you stand to your feet for the reading of the word as we begin our reading today at Luke 6, verse 37, where Jesus admonishes us, "Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you." He told them this parable. Can the blind lead the blind? Will they not both fall into a pit? The student is not above the teacher, but everyone who is fully trained will be like their teacher. Verse 41, "Why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye and pay no attention to the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, 'Brother, let me take the speck out of your eye,' when you yourself fail to see the plank in your own eye? You hypocrite. First take the plank out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Would you bow your heads with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of your word that penetrates our hearts and our lives, that transcends geographic borders and cultures, and inspires us to wash off our windshields so that we might see the path that you have laid before us. Lord, help us today. Help us today to move forward in unity and alignment with your Holy Spirit. In Christ Jesus' name, let all God's people say, amen. You may be seated. All right, friends. I'm going to shoot straight with you. Not going to beat around the bush. Got a lot of things going on today. We have a problem. We have a problem, each and every one of us. The problem is an obstructed view. In Luke chapter 6, the first part of verse 42, we read, "How can you say to your brother, 'Brother, let me take the speck out of your eye,' when you yourself fail to see the plank in your own eye?" Friends, I would encourage you that many times we fail to be able to help others because we have an obstruction. We can't adequately see the needs of others, nor can we see the path that God has laid out to help meet those needs because of the obstructions in our lives. Now, obstructions take on many different forms. Sometimes our view is obstructed by those pesky things, the things that are outside of our control. You know, when you're driving your car and that giant dragonfly hits the windshield right in front of you. Once upon a time, when Aniansi and I refinanced our house to buy a tour bus, we were driving across the United States and we'd made our way into North Texas on our way to Abilene. And just as we crossed the border into Texas, I saw something hit the windshield and I heard a sound like rain, only to discover that the flat windshield of our tour bus had hit a swarm of bees. A swarm. I don't know if you've ever hit a swarm of bees, the windshield of your car before, but let me tell you what it looks like. It looks like a dark and ominous day is what it looks like. I don't care how much fluid is loaded up into that reservoir. When you try and shoot it on there, those bee guts don't want to move. We drove that same tour bus into Florida, where they have a unique creature. How many of you know there are many unique creatures in Florida? They are nicknamed love bugs because you will seldom find two of them separated from each other in flight. So they hit the windshield in pairs. They stick. There's an acidic quality in their blood that will eat through the finish of the clear coat and rust a vehicle if they're not washed away quickly. Yeah, those things are pesky, and they're out of our control, and they obstruct our view. And it's the unkind word that somebody says to you, or when somebody cuts you off on the road, and you had the right of way. That light was not quite red yet. Then there are some things that we bring upon ourselves that obstruct our view. I'm not talking about spilling a soda across your windshield. That seems like a pretty silly thing to do. I'm talking about the choices we make, the sin in our lives that gets in the way. Many different forms, many different shapes. Our view can be obstructed by many different things. And sometimes what obstructs our view is what seems to be good to us. There's a pastor that I served alongside in his semi-retirement a number of years ago named Harley Allen. His son is now the district superintendent for the Northern California Nevada District of the Assemblies of God. And in a staff meeting, I heard Pastor Harley say a quote from a leadership book, that good is the enemy of best. See, sometimes the good things around us obstruct our view from being able to see the best that God has for us. There was a guy described in the New Testament of the Bible who seemed to be a pretty good guy. He followed all the rules. He had it all down. In fact, he was a Pharisee. He knew the rules inside and out. He was the guy responsible for telling other people what the rules were and enforcing the rules. This guy was named Saul of Tarsus. He was there when Stephen was stoned. He was glad to see Stephen stoned because Stephen belonged to this crazy sect of people who were following this radical that they thought they'd gotten rid of when they nailed him to the cross, and then his body disappeared 3 days later, and his followers claimed that he had rose from the grave by his own power. He claimed to be the Son of God. Yes, Saul of Tarsus, he thought he was doing a good thing by rounding up these followers of Jesus. People who heard Jesus say, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," and they called themselves the people of the way. That's what's described in Acts chapter 9, beginning at verse 1. Meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. He went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue in Damascus so that if he found any of those who belonged to the way, whether men or women, he might take them as prisoners to Jerusalem. Yes, Saul's obstructed view led to the imprisonment and execution of early Christians while threatening to prevent others from hearing the good news of Jesus. Friends, obstruction leads to destruction. Obstruction leads to destruction. If we don't wash the windshield of our lives, we run the risk of getting into a collision. And perhaps suffering a loss of life. Or worse yet, like Saul, preventing those that we love from living eternal life with Christ, all because of a dirty windshield. I believe that overlooking obstructions brings blindness. This literally happened to Saul. He was overlooking the obstructions in his life, the legalism that had taken hold of him. He was overlooking the cruelty that he was showing to the people of the way, the first Christians. And he was blinded because of it. God used Saul's physical blindness to expose his spiritual darkness. We read in Acts chapter 9, beginning at verse 8, of how Saul had just seen this bright light before him on the road to Damascus, and all of those traveling with him fell to the ground, but he looked up, he looked into the light, and there, coming from the light, he heard the voice of Jesus, the resurrected Savior of the world, speaking out, saying, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" But Saul did not recognize his voice because even his hearing was obstructed. He didn't realize that this was the promised Messiah. He did not accept Jesus as Lord and Savior. And he said to the one calling to him from the light, he said, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you persecute." When Saul arose, we pick up the story in Acts chapter 9, verse 8. Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand into Damascus. For 3 days he was blind, and he did not eat or drink anything. Here's the one who had the power. Here's the one who had the clout. Here's the one who had authority. He was leading people on a rampage to round up these rebel followers of Jesus. And his obstructed view led him right into the path of the glory of Almighty God, whose radiance was so great that big, tough Saul was blinded when he looked upon Jesus. Yes, overlooking obstructions brings blindness. It can blind us to God's will. But obstructions do not remove themselves. It's interesting to me. How many times we think that things will just work themselves out in time. But time does not heal all wounds. God is able to heal all wounds if we will submit ourselves to Him. God used a Christian named Ananias as an agent of the Holy Spirit to help Saul receive his sight. And God did not call this follower of Jesus to condemn Saul for his heinous acts, for his sin, but rather to lay hands upon him that he might receive freedom and healing by the power of the Holy Spirit. We read about this in Acts chapter 19, beginning at verse 17. Then Ananias went to the house and entered it. Placing his hands on Saul, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you were coming here, has sent me to you, that you may see again and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Verse 18, immediately something like scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again. He got up and was baptized. And after taking some food, he regained his strength. Friends, I want to just say to you that this whole thing, this isn't just some bedtime story. This isn't just some casual occurrence. This isn't some person slowly working their way into church and kind of meandering into the family of God with this kind of haphazard, soft, feel-good faith. This is a radical transformation of one who thought he was doing the right thing but was in fact sinning every day with every step he took. This is the radical transformation of one who had gained the appreciation and admiration of a sinful world. This is the radical transformation of one who would drag off men and women, not just to imprisonment, but often to their eventual death by stoning. And we know it's a radical transformation because Saul did something absolutely radical in the first century. He was baptized in the name of Jesus. He went public with his faith. He didn't just come into the quiet place of the church and when everybody bowed their heads and closed their eyes, slip his hands up anonymously so that only the pastor and God could see. No, he got up in front of everyone and he said, "I am a follower of Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life." And Saul was publicly baptized and thereby marked for death. Make no mistake, this was the inauguration of Paul's ministry, of God doing the greatest work in his life, a man whom the Lord would use under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit to pen about half of the New Testament. His name was changed from Saul to Paul, from strong to weak, from leader to servant, from bully to brother. What's the message that Jesus spoke in Luke 6? The message that Saul of Tarsus lived when he dipped into those waters of baptism? It was a recognition that there is a need to remove the gunk. Jesus said in Luke 6, the latter part of verse 42, "You hypocrite, first take the plank out of your eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye." Sometimes when we hear this quoted, there's a lot of emphasis on that word hypocrite, like Jesus is angry. Maybe he is. It's not really a nice word. It's not a compliment. I've never heard hypocrite used as a compliment. Never. But based on what Jesus says next, it's simply an acknowledgement of the truth. Your vision's blurred. You have obstructed vision. You're not seeing the truth. You who claim to be so righteous, who claim to do everything right, you're doing the wrong thing. That makes you a hypocrite. So here's what I want you to do, says the Savior of the world. take the plank out of your eye. Why? Because I want you to have a gaping hole in your head? No. Because Jesus is the healer, and he can give you the ability to see clearly so that you can be used by God even to remove the specks from your brother's eyes, not to persecute, not to ridicule, not to condemn, but to be an agent of healing, just as Ananias was when he laid hands on Saul. Merriam-Webster's dictionary defines gunk as filthy, stinky, or greasy matter. I think gunk is a good word to describe the stuff that clutters the windshield of our lives, the stuff that clouds our physical and spiritual vision. It's gunk. It's filthy, it's stinky, it's greasy. What is that gunk? It's anything that gets in the way of allowing you and I to move forward in God's will. It needs to be cleaned up. First step to cleaning it, I believe, is a decision to resist comparisons. We need to stop saying, if I had a car like that, my windshield would always be clean. Or, at least my windshield's cleaner than their windshield. My stuff doesn't stink like their stuff. Come on. Mm-mm. You know, it's interesting how our selfishness can turn around other people's actions and behavior as justification for our own denial, sin, deceit, malice, rough edges, call it what you will, the gunk in our lives. No, we need to resist comparisons. Philippians chapter 2, beginning of verse 3, tells us, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. How can we do that? We got to take the planks out of our eyes. We got to clean off our windshields. We got to stop comparing. Secondly, we need to request correction. Yes, I said request correction. We need the Holy Spirit to expose things that are gunking up the windshield of our lives. The psalmist writes in Psalm 139, beginning of verse 23, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." It does not say, "Hey, God, take a quick glance in my direction. Lord, I want you to only listen to the spirit behind my words, but not really my words themselves, and please don't be reading my mind. I know you can do that, God." It doesn't say, "God, if there are some really obvious big things that are worse than everybody else's big things, then would you just kind of bring those to my attention so that, you know, I could just get by and squeak into heaven, skin of my teeth, but enjoy all that this world has to offer that would threaten my relationship with you and my testimony to others?" It does not say that at all. No. See, this is the prayer that I pray. Hallelujah. Whoa. Not sure what that was, but I'm pretty sure it was not from God. It's a prayer that I pray every Sunday morning before I take the pulpit. "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me, any sliver. Lead me in the way everlasting so that I may lead your church in a manner that honors and glorifies you." We have to request correction. I heard an expert on volunteerism talked about the steps to bringing correction in a ministry. Three steps: connect, inspect, and correct. That's what we need to do with God. We need to connect with God in prayer. We need to invite him to inspect the deepest recesses of our hearts and minds, where the enemy hides the gunk, the corners of the windshield. You know that line down the middle where the squeegee doesn't quite reach? You know which one I'm talking about? That part underneath the windshield wipers, it's just a hassle to go ahead and pull the windshield wipers back. Let's just leave the gunk there so that when it rains, the windshield wipers will put the gunk back up on the windshield. You know what I'm talking about? We need to invite God to inspect and then receive his correction. Receive it when he says, okay, here's the next step. Because can I tell you something? My experience has been there's always a next step. Here at Radiant Life Church, we're committed to sharing life's journey through growing relationship with Jesus Christ. Can I tell you something? That makes me feel young, because young people grow. You want to feel young again? Invite God to help you grow, because there are only one of two things happening, friends. We're either growing or we're already dead. I don't know about you, but growing sounds pretty good. Anybody? Growing? Yeah, go for growing. Let's go for growing, growing. That means that we have to repent without withholding. Sometimes the smallest specks are the hardest to scrape off, but when they're allowed to remain, they always seem to spread. In 1 John chapter 1, beginning at verse 8, we are admonished, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. How much unrighteousness, therefore, should we confess to him? All of it. Why hold anything back? If he can cleanse us from all unrighteousness, purify us completely, so that we might be holy and blameless before him, what then might he do through his spotless church? We are his church. We are the bride of Christ. How many of you know that there is a tremendous joy on the wedding day when the bride approaches the groom? They see each other dressed and ready to enter into a union. That's why the groom changes his t-shirt, his socks, and his underpants. He rents a tuxedo. He spends good money on it and color coordinates it just as he was instructed. And he gets shoes that shine no matter how uncomfortable they are. That's why he does it. And that's why she spends the next 3 months of his salary getting her hair, her makeup, her nails done. And then maybe she goes out for a nice little lunch with her girlfriends. And then she starts trying on those dresses. And she looks for the one that seems most perfectly suited for her, that reveals something about her personality and shows off her best features, so that when she approaches her groom on that wedding day, he goes, wow. I am so glad I put on deodorant this morning. Wow. I'm holding nothing back. I'm holding nothing back because God has something great in store. And he will purify us from all unrighteousness if we will simply lay it all at the feet of Jesus. And when we do that, we begin to recognize our position. A clean windshield allows us to see where we are, where we're going, and the path that will move us from here to there. I would encourage you today, the words of Romans chapter 12, beginning at verse 3. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. Every time I talk to someone who professes Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, calls themselves a Christian, I ask, where do you worship? Where do you go to church? Where is your church home? And the reason I ask that question is because I want to know. I want to know if this follower of Jesus is plugged into a community of faith where there are people who can speak into their life and help them to grow and mature, and where they can use the gifts that God's given and develop those gifts for his glory in an environment where they will be encouraged to grow in their faith. And when I hear someone who's following Jesus say that they don't have a church home, or worse yet, start saying how horrible certain churches are, or how there's no perfect church, you be bashing on the bride of Christ now. You never win points with the groom by bashing on the bride. Never. You love the groom, you help her out. You become part of the solution. You get plugged in. My understanding of Scripture, there's really no excuse for a Christian not to be in fellowship in a body of believers. There is no perfect church. There is no perfect church. This is not a perfect church. This is simply a church populated with imperfect people who are committed to being transformed by the perfect Savior of the world and becoming more and more like him every day. That's what sharing life's journey through growing relationship with Jesus Christ is all about. Friends, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you that as we recognize our position, we see that God has a plan for each and every one of us, and we can remain focused forward. It's a shame that some of us seem to have a sparkling clean windshield, but we're so distracted by our side windows, our mirrors, our radios, our consoles, our glove compartments, our cell phones. Uh-oh. He just went there. That we miss what God has right in front of us. We're so distracted. We miss what's plain to see. That's why Proverbs 4:25 says, "Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you." God's laying a path out for you and me that leads us right where he wants us to be. In Romans chapter 6, verse 4, "We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life." God has a new life for each and every one of us. From this day forward, we can choose to live new and fresh every moment moving forward in his will. That requires washing the windshield. Washing the windshield means removing the gunk by resisting comparisons. Washing the windshield means removing the gunk by requesting correction. Washing the windshield means removing the gunk by repenting without withholding. Washing the windshield means removing the gunk by recognizing our position. Washing the windshield means removing the gunk by remaining focused forward so we can see the path God has for us.